All right, well, we've played a little bit of musical chairs this morning, but I think we've got everybody here now, and so we're going to go ahead and get started. I'm happy to be here. I hope you're happy to be here. I want to pray with you, and then Miss Denise is going to come and lead us in worship, and then I'll come back and bring the message to you this morning. So let's pray. Father, we love you, and Lord, we're thankful that we can be here this morning. We're thankful that your presence is with us this morning, and Lord, we're here to worship you, and Father, we pray you'd give us a great service today. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's turn this off. Life and health and peace. He breaks the power of canceled sin. He sets the prisoner free. His blood can make the foulest clean. His blood avail for me. My gracious Master and my God, assist me to proclaim, to spread through all the earth abroad, the honors of thy name.
Thank you. You may be seated. Every day they pass me by, I can see it in their eyes. Empty people filled with care, headed who knows where. On they go through private pain, living fear to fear. Laughter hides their silent cry. Only Jesus hears. People need the
law.
Good morning again. You've got your Bibles and you're turning to Psalm, the book of Psalm, in the 24th chapter. And we're talking about our core values still. We're back to our core values series. And this morning, we're going to talk about one of our core values being worship. Worship is one of our core values. Now, while you're flipping your Bibles there, let me just share something with you. And I'm just being real with you for a minute. I'm coming from the heart, okay? I am ticked. I'm ticked. Why, preacher? Why are you mad? Why are you ticked off? I'm mad that my friend and church member Bud Hollifield went to a hospital and died and I couldn't see him. I'm mad that my friend and church member Jerry Petit went to the hospital and died and I couldn't see him. I'm mad that my friend and church member Perry McKinney had a stroke, went to the hospital, and is in a nursing home and I can't see him. I'm mad that Trish Revis is still in a nursing home and I can't see her. I'm mad that things are happening with you folks and I can't see you. I'm mad that I can't take my family places right now without a hint of fear. I'm mad about a lot of stuff. You might resonate with me on some of that. But let me tell you what I will not let it do. I will not let it stop me from my worship. Worship has to be a core value of who and what we are as a church and as individual Christians. You've got your Bibles. You're in Psalm 24, and we're going to look at the first verse. Listen to what it says. The earth is the Lord's and all it contains, the world and those who dwell in it. For he has founded it upon the seas and established it upon the rivers. Who may ascend into the hill of the Lord? And who may stand in his holy place? He who has clean hands and a pure heart, who has not lifted his soul to falsehood and has not sworn deceitfully, he shall receive a blessing from the Lord and righteousness from the God of his salvation. This is the generation of those who seek him, who seek your face, O God of Jacob. Pray with me, Father. Bless the reading of your word as we've now read it, and be with us in this time of worship. In Jesus' name, amen. So again, this morning, we are continuing in our series. We're looking at our 12 core values. The fourth core value is worship, okay? This week, I want to share with you that it is absolutely important that one of our core values be worship. I'm going to tell you something. Worship is an absolute must for a growing and thriving church. If we don't have it down and don't understand what it means to worship God, then we're backing up. We're not going forward. Worship had better be at the top of the list if we want to be a growing church, and not only growing in numbers, that's not all what I'm talking about, but growing spiritually in our hearts as individual Christians and church members as well. Worship is essential for a Christian. And the Christian that doesn't worship misses out on one of the best and most meaningful times that you can have with God. Now, when I say the word worship, immediately some of you in your minds jump straight to music. And music is a great way to worship, but there are so many other ways to worship outside of music. Music is just a part of worship. You see, everything that we do here should be worship. The time of preaching and listening to preaching is worship. The time of singing, yeah, that's part of worship too. The time of giving our tithes and offerings, that's part of worship. Praying is part of worship. Worship is a huge deal to God, and it ought to be a huge deal to us. You see, there's personal worship, where it's just you and God time. Then there's corporate worship, where we all come together and worship as a congregation. The 24th Psalm that we've read this morning, it's actually a really interesting psalm. It's a praise song that David is said to have written when he went to get the Ark of the Covenant from the house of Obed-Edom. And this was an exciting time for David, as well as the entire Hebrew nation. They were excited that the Ark of the Covenant was going to be retrieved, and the Ark had been out of Israel's possession for about 50 years at this point, and David was going to get it back. And so guess what? It was a time of celebration for these people. They were excited. Let's take a look at our text. The psalmist begins in verse 1 by declaring the sovereignty of God and saying that he is the creator of the earth. You know, he's saying that everything is God's. All of it. It all belongs to God. Everything you see, everything you touch, it all belongs to God. Every part of the earth, every region, every body of water, everything is God's. And if you are a child of God, then no matter where you go, you are not out of His sight. You are still on His creation. The psalmist is showing the magnitude of God right now in this part of the text. He's showing us how big God is. How amazing, how incredible God is. It says that the earth and all it contains are His, including those who dwell in it. What does that mean? It means we all belong to Him. Even those who aren't saved are His. They just don't know Him. But He knows who they are. He created them. He knows every hair on their head, just like He knows every hair on your head. In the second verse, we're told the reason why the world belongs to God. It says the biggest reason is that He created it. It's His. This God, which by the way, I believe is the only God, demands and deserves our praise and worship to Him. And I wonder what it does to Him when the Christian refuses to worship. Again, there's different kinds of worship. All of them are expected. My question is, do most of us give any form of worship to God? After all He's done for us, sometimes we get so concerned about ourselves that we neglect and rob the Creator of His deserved worship. Let's look at our text again. Verse 3 raises a good question. It says, "Who shall ascend into the hill of the Lord?" And then the psalmist explains who will have the honor of standing in the presence of the Lord. He answers this way. He says, "He who has clean hands and a pure heart and who has not lifted his soul to falsehood." You know, there's a song with those words in it. I love that song. It says, "Give us clean hands and give us pure hearts and let us not lift our soul to another." It's a great song and it's based off of this text. But you see, as we know, unfortunately, everyone is not heaven bound. There's a whole lot of lost people right now in this world, and they're not heaven bound. Evil and darkness and wickedness is not allowed in the presence of God. And therefore, if you've not been covered and washed in the blood of the Lord Jesus, you're not able to stand one day in the presence of God. However, washing your hands in the water just like Pilate did during Jesus' trial, that's not going to cut it. You see, you can't just wash this kind of sin away with water. That won't work. The guiltiness of our sin cannot be washed away with water. It can only be washed away with what, church? Tell me out loud. The blood of Jesus. The blood of Jesus. But the psalmist doesn't stop with saying that you must have clean hands. He makes it clear that your clean hands must be accompanied by what? A pure heart. An illustration for this is kind of like a car. You can clean the outside of your car and you can shine the outside of your car up real nice and you can put a coat of wax on it and you can make it look brand new again and everyone will assume that you have a clean car. But if you don't clean the inside of your car, guess what? It's still filthy. And people who aren't aware of the condition of the vehicle's interior, they may think that you have it all together, but you know you don't. Because you know what the inside of your car looks like. Folks, we can clean the exterior of our lives as much as we want. And you can claim to be blameless on the outside, but the truth of the gospel is this. God can see the inside of your heart. He knows what's going on inside of your heart. He knows what's really going on. And so we must not only have clean hands, but we must also have a pure heart when we come to worship. Again, as we talk about worship this morning, we must understand this is what God expects from us during our worship time. We come to worship with a pure heart. We've asked forgiveness of our sins. We've done everything we can do to have a pure heart. We've asked God to give us clean hands. We've asked forgiveness for things that we've done maybe that week or in the past, and we're doing our best to come before the Lord in a time of worship with clean hands and a pure heart. We should come to church with our hearts already examined. Again, asking God to give us clean hands and a pure heart. Now, you can attempt to worship in a different way for as long as you want. But when you have made your life right and your heart right and you come pure to the throne of God and begin to worship Him, that is real worship for the Christian to experience, and there's nothing like it. No other experience that comes close to it. Another thing that the psalmist says is that we must not lift our soul to falsehood, to any other god. You know, another way you could describe what the psalmist is trying to say is that he's describing the birthmarks of a born-again believer. Every human has their joys, which lifts them up. The worldly person lifts up their soul to carnal things or temporary things, but the Christian has more love for the things that are more substantial. Someone who has been born again wants to feed on the things of God. They're hungry. They're thirsty for what God can teach them. It's a sign of being a true Christian. And the one who is just born in this world will find their joy in the things of this world, not in the things of God. Do not misunderstand this text. Let me clarify that. The psalmist is not saying that you do these things in order to be saved. He is saying that those who have been truly saved will do this. This is all part of worship. I believe that in a lot of our churches today, worship has been set aside for other things. And one of the biggest things that God demands and expects from us is worship, and we should never neglect to give Him what He deserves from us. But, hear me, it is impossible for us to have dirty hands and an impure heart and at the same time our hearts be in worship mode. We can't do it. If we're loaded down with sin and we're loaded down with all kinds of things going on in our lives that aren't supposed to be going on and we've not asked forgiveness for that stuff, you can't worship God like that. You can try, but it's not going to work well for you. We're to come to Him with clean hands and a pure heart. You see, we were born with dirty hands. All of us. Why? Why is that? Why were we born with dirty hands? Because we inherited the sin of Adam. We were born with an impure heart. But those of us who have been saved and trusted in Christ now have the Holy Spirit, which the Bible says dwells within our hearts. And when we allow impure things to enter, it quenches what He wants to do in our lives. But even after we've been saved, even after we've become a Christian, there's some maintaining that we have to do. There's some maintenance that we got to take care of. The Bible is clear that we should come to church for three reasons. Worship, Christian fellowship with each other, and the teaching and preaching of Scripture. Okay? It's very clear. We see that in the Word of God. If you come for anything else other than those three reasons, I think you're probably wrong. Those are the three purposes that we come together as Christians. If you're coming to church and you're not able to participate in fellowship with each other, and you're not able to worship, and you're not able to be fed the Word of God, then maybe you need to check your hands. Maybe they're dirty. If your hands are weighted down with gossip and jealousy and backbiting or slander, then until you get rid of that stuff in your life, you're not going to be able to lift them up and worship God in the way that He deserves. You know, unfortunately, many Christians have dirty hands and their heart is everything but pure. And that is keeping them from the happiness that they deserve. It's keeping them from the Christian fellowship that they deserve. It's keeping them from giving God the worship that He deserves. We need to check our hands and check our hearts. And if our hands aren't clean, we need to ask God to help us have clean hands. And if our heart is impure, then we need to ask God to forgive us and give us a pure heart. And He will, and then you'll be able to worship in the way that you should, and grow in your faith. I'm going to share three things with you quick. These aren't going to be long points. These are going to be short points. But three things to remember when we come to worship. Number one, we must have a proper perspective. We must have a proper perspective on worship. If our perspective of worship is off, then our worship will be off. And if our worship is off, then we're not walking with Christ in the way that He wants us to. And if we don't fix whatever is causing us to not be able to worship, it will only get worse. And if we continue to ignore the guiltiness that covers our hands or the impurities that clouds our heart, we will miss out on what the Christian faith is supposed to be about. Let me give you an example about why we need to fix stuff immediately. If something gets into our heart or on our hands that isn't supposed to be there. Let me tell you why. I'm a redneck, and so I only know how to give redneck analogies. Can y'all hang with me? With my deer rifle, if I go to my gun club and I go to the 50-yard range first to sight my scope in on my rifle, and I pull the trigger and it goes to the bullseye, but it's an inch off to the left, and I don't fix that scope immediately, but I back up to 100 yards. Tommy, you're a fellow redneck. What's going to happen? You're going to be 2 inches from the bullseye now. And if I back up even further without fixing my scope or my rifle, and I go even further back and I pull the trigger, not only is it 1 inch off and then it was 2 inches off, guess what? Now I'm 3 or 4 or 5 inches away from the bullseye. Here's the analogy. God is the bullseye. And if you find yourself missing the bullseye, you better fix it now. Otherwise, you're going to go further and further and further and further. And next thing you know, you blink your eyes and you've been out of church for 4 or 5 years and you're not praying and you're not reading your Bible and nobody could tell you were a Christian by the way you live. That's how fast it happens. God is the bullseye, and we keep our eyes on the bullseye. And when we get off of that bullseye just a little bit, we go to the Lord right then and we say, God, forgive me. Give me clean hands and give me a pure heart because I want to stay on the bullseye. We must come to worship with a proper perspective. Second thing, we must have properly prepared. You know, coming to church to worship, it's more than just getting up and driving and getting here, right? There's some prep work that goes into our worship. If we fail to prepare our hearts for worship, then again, it's not going to be as good as it can be. As we begin to worship Him and get to the point where we desire in that moment to be close to Him, we must remember that God does not let sin into His presence. He won't, He can't. And in order to prepare properly for a time of true worship, we must go to Him beforehand and seek forgiveness and ask Him to cleanse our hands from the sin that we're involved in and to give us a pure heart. You know what that looks like? It's as simple as what I just said. Really, it ought to be daily, but on Saturday night or early Sunday morning. God, when I get to church tomorrow morning or later this morning, I want to be able to worship You in the most purest and honest way that I possibly can because, God, I really want a word from You and I really want to experience Your presence in my life at church when I get there during the service. And so, God, because I want that, I'm asking You right now, Lord, if there's anything on my hands that are dirty, forgive me. Wash me of that. God, if there's any iniquity and sin in my heart, whether it's known sin or unknown sin, God, forgive me for that sin because I want to worship You when I get to church in that service. That's how we prepare for worship. By the way, asking for His forgiveness is a form of worship. You see, you've already started the worship service before you even got to church, and that's great. That's very possible. You see, that's when real worship starts, by you confessing your faults and sins to Him and then seeing that He loves you enough to wipe the slate clean yet again. And hopefully we see how much He loves us as a result of that. It's an amazing love that God has for each and every one of us. He sent His Son to die for our sins, and yet all of us still commit sins on a regular basis. And even though He already gave us more than He had to, He's ready and willing to forgive us again and again and again and again. Number three, we must have a proper pursuit. You see, we come to worship, but we've properly pursued the Lord before that service and during that time of worship. The person who is ready for worship will pursue God. They'll chase after God. The psalmist said this. He said, "It is the generation of those who seek Him, who seek Your face, O God of Jacob." They sought after Him. Again, in order to really worship, you must pursue God. I once heard Adrian Rogers say this: "I don't know how much you have of God, but you have all that you want." Let that sink in. I don't know how much you have of God, but you have all that you want. How much of God do you want, church? And if again, if you're coming to church in the pursuit of anything other than God, then you're missing out. And you're wrong in your motivation for being here. We come here to hear the preaching of the Word of God, to sing and worship God, to fellowship with other believers in God, but mainly we come to pursue God and hear a word from Him. That's why we come. You know, it's my hope that not only when you're here at church, but even in your personal life, throughout your daily life, that you will seek Him, pursue Him, and discover worship is not only a core value of Cross Memorial, but it ought to be a core value of your personal life. However, in order to keep worship as a core value of our church and in your personal life, we must have the proper perspective of worship, and we must properly prepare for worship, and we must pursue the one whom we desire to worship. A parable is told of a community of ducks waddling off to duck church one Sunday to hear their duck preacher. And after they waddled into the duck sanctuary, the service began, and the duck preacher spoke eloquently of how God had given the ducks wings with which to fly. And he pounded the pulpit with his beak, and he said, "With these wings, there is nowhere we ducks cannot go. There is no God-given task we ducks cannot accomplish. And with these wings, we no longer walk or need to walk through life. We can soar high in the sky." And shouts of amen were quacked throughout the duck congregation. The duck preacher concluded his message by exclaiming, "With our wings, we can fly through life. We can fly," he preached. And more ducks quacked out loud with amens in response. And every duck loved the service. In fact, all the ducks that were present commented on what a wonderfully convicting message they had heard from their duck preacher. And then they left the church and waddled all the way home. Did you hear the problem with that? What's the application? Too often we waddle away from worship the same way that we waddled in, unchanged. How often do we come in and go out of here with no change in our life? That duck preacher preached a whole sermon about how God had given them the capability to fly, and they waddled home instead of flying. There was no change in the life of the ducks. I hope that this morning can be a good refresher of the fact that we can be changed through a time of worship. God can change us, heal us, do whatever He wants to with us if our hearts are pure and our hands are clean. God deserves our worship. And He doesn't deserve lazy worship. He deserves for us to pursue Him and to follow what His Word tells us to do. And when it comes to the topic of worship, what does He tell us to do? Have clean hands and a pure heart when we come to Him to worship. Would you stand and pray with me, and we'll be dismissed? Oh, Father, we love You. And Lord, we know that corporate worship is trying right now. It's tough. Lord, there's so much going on in our country right now and in the whole world. Your church has been affected on every continent. But Lord, we pray that we would not allow it to stop us from worshiping you, whether we are homebound or in a nursing home or in a hospital room or in a sanctuary or in a parking lot service or wherever we are at the time that we're worshiping. Lord, we pray that we have done our due diligence. We pray that we have properly prepared. We pray that we have pursued you like we ought to. We pray that our perspective of worship is on cue. Because, Lord, we wouldn't dare want to bring you any other worship that wasn't the kind you've asked from us, with a pure heart and clean hands. We wouldn't dare want to be lazy in our worship. We wouldn't dare want to insult you. Father, we pray that your word has spoken to us and reminded us this morning of how we are to worship you and how great of a God you are. Lord, I pray blessings on everybody here this morning. I pray blessings on all of our church members, those that are in the hospital and nursing homes and that are homebound for the time being. Father, I pray that, Lord, that this word would penetrate their hearts as well where they are. And Lord, I pray that not just here at Cross Memorial, but that believers all across the world would get back to worshiping you the way that you deserve. And I pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Church, I love you. Have a great week. See you next Sunday.